to marvel at God, if you need a reason to be thankful, go outside and look at the stars. It's like, thank you, God. You didn't have to do that. You are heirs with God and joint heirs with Christ. The earth he has given to the sons of men. You are kings and priests. Enjoy my creation. Have dominion over it. Subdue it. The book of Genesis says, I made all this for my glory and for your good. So stand in awe and wonder to the God who made heavens. His mercy endures forever. If you need things to be thankful for, look backwards. Do this in remembrance. Look back at your story and say, wow, God, you answered some prayers. He's like, you know what? When I look back at Israel's narrative, remember, they were less individualistic. So to him, this is a blessing as he looks back patriotically at his nation's past. He says, me and my people, God, you've been very, very good to us. Because when all is said and done, you look back and you're like, you know what? I went through some real battles, but Pharaoh drowned in the sea. Thank you, God. You've been very good to me. I know you have battles and it's hard to be thankful. When you're fighting battles, remember that the Hebrew word for prayer literally means to wrestle. Just like Jacob, his thigh was popped out of socket when he wrestled. If you're wrestling through stuff tonight, that is a form of prayer. Be the 10%, the leper who turned back to praise. 1 out of 10 turned back to praise Jesus for healing them. Lead a lifestyle of thanks living. Why? I'll give you one major reason to live a life of thanksgiving, because, my friends, his mercy endures forever.
Walking with God should be so fun.
It should be so fun, where desires and dreams are coming to fruition. Why? Because they're no longer the plans that I concocted for my life. It's just all this stuff God dreamed up. We should suck all the marrow out of life and put to rout anything that is not life. Lest we die with our song still inside us. Lest we live a life of quiet desperation. Nothing wrong with having fun. I just drove through redwoods today. God made those for us to explore. Like, they're there. The biggest trees thus far discovered in the universe are 2 hours away from us. Adventures with God, adventures with squad. Forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. Take a crew and go explore the redwoods. Do you know how many people wish they lived near the redwoods? We do. Enjoy the joy of being enjoyed by God. Don't make an agony out of your religion. Have fun. Have fun. You have permission. But what this generation needs is what Paul said. You are the epistle written on our hearts. You are the only Bible some people will ever read. Peace is found in the New Testament 80 times. Joy is a thesis thread that runs through the theme of the treatise of truth. We got to live joy. We got to live peace. We got to put feet to our faith. We got to find the fullness of joy in his presence, pleasures forevermore at his right hand. Man, there's no reason that can't be us. I hope that we go down as the generation that was literally the most hope-filled generation of history, and then future generations and posterity are going to read about us, and they're going to look back and say, how can we be like them?
I'm Ben Courson, and you're watching Hope Generation. Today's teaching is entitled Anointing Oil, as we learn about the mysterious anointing oil dripping from the beard of Aaron.
Psalm 133, a song of ascents of David, verse 1, behold how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious oil upon the head running down on the beard of who? The beard of Aaron, that's huge. Running down on the edge of his garments, it is like the dew of Hermon descending upon the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord commanded the blessing, life.
forevermore.
In this passage, he tells us that it's so good when people dwell together in a harmonious situation, when brothers dwell together in unity. In this passage, Paul is talking about the fellowship of the mystery, the mysterion, the unity that we not only receive reconciliation between God and man, but between man and man. And what I've learned is that usually my closest friends are either like really good at what they do, best in their field, or they love God. And usually it's an amalgamation and conglomeration of the two. And what unites us is the Christ dimension, which is greater than any difference that might otherwise divide us. And that's why the church can be so unified, because regardless of age or stage or gender or socioeconomic position or racial identity, we can all come together in the Christ that unites us, which is always greater than the differences that might otherwise divide us. You can experience what Paul called the fellowship of the mystery, where all over the world, there are a lot of people who are worshiping the same God you love, and that's what unites us together. It's the love of God that passes all knowledge. How beautiful it is when people of all kinds of personality types, people of all kinds of socioeconomic backgrounds, all types of ethnicities, all types of hobbies, people who come from all parts of the world, how beautiful it is for brothers, he says, to dwell together in unity. Now, how beautiful is it? He says it's as beautiful as the oil that is falling down the beard of who? Of Aaron. Now, I want to talk to you a little bit about the anointing oil of Aaron. So when people are dwelling together harmoniously, it's as beautiful as the oil dripping down Aaron's beard. Now, if you're like me, and we come from the West in the 21st century, like post-enlightenment, post-industrial revolution, post-renaissance, like we come post-neoclassical age, post-modernism, some people say post-truth. When we read a text like this, like that's not aesthetically pleasing to us. Like if I think, what's a very beatific picture? Like what's a beautiful vision? I don't think of a old priest's beard with oil dripping down it. I think your beard's oily, dude. Like please shampoo that thing. That's what I think. When I initially saw this, I'm like, why is he saying it's beautiful for Aaron's beard to be oily? Like that doesn't make sense to me. But actually, when you understand what it is, and I just learned about this today, studying this today, it was actually something very beautiful. The shortest chapter in the Bible is Psalm 117, which says, "The Lord's truth endures forever." Now, that word truth in the Hebrew language is emeth, and the Jewish scholars and doctors tell us that that word's really interesting because it contains the first letter of the Hebrew alphabet, aleph, the middle letter of the Hebrew alphabet, mem, and the last letter of the Hebrew alphabet, which is tau. And they say that's because the alpha and omega has a truth that is our comfort all in all from A to Z. In the same way, the Bible says that God is the author and the finisher of our faith. Paul said, "He who began a good work in you will be faithful to finish it." Now that word for finish or complete is the word telestai in Greek, the same word that Jesus used on the cross when he said, "Te telestai, it is finished." Paul hijacked that word and was saying, as surely as Jesus carried his cross to completion, so too the Alpha and Omega will telestai, finish the work that he's begun in you. God is not just somebody who starts a project, he's somebody who finishes it to perfection. He's faithful all in all from A to Z, the Alpha and the Omega. The priests, when they were serving in the tabernacle, they had anointing oil. So the sons of Aaron was Moses' brother, Remember, Moses was supposed to be the priest who spoke to God for the people and spoke to the people for God, but he kept saying why God couldn't use him. He was so eloquent that he used 10 different ways to say the same thing. Can't speak, even though the New Testament says he was eloquent in Pharaoh's courts, but he didn't see himself properly. So God chose Aaron, Moses' brother, to be the head of the priestly order. And Aaron and his sons, the priests, they would have oil. Now, this anointing oil smelled beautiful.
Life cycles in seasons. When autumn falls upon us and winter looms in front of us, we can still lead a lifestyle of thanksgiving. In the story of Jesus and the lepers, only one out of the 10 that had been healed turned back to give thanks. We are going to be in the 10% that show gratitude. Out of the 860.3 million words we speak in a lifetime, let's make a lot of those words of thankfulness.
We'll return for more of today's message after this.
People are always asking themselves what job they're going to get that's going to pay their bills until they die. The question you should be asking is what makes you happy and how are you going to turn that into your life? We only get one life. And we were never promised a long time. So let's make it a good time.
Very passionate about religion versus relationship. Religion is I messed up, don't tell dad. Sonship is I messed up, I better call dad. But relationship or sonship says come boldly to a throne of grace. The anointing oil, it was made of cinnamon. So picture the smell of cinnamon wafting in your nose. It was also made of myrrh. So it was made of cinnamon and myrrh and other natural compounds and ingredients. So remember how Jesus said the kingdom of God is like a woman kneading dough, like with a K, kneading dough? It starts out small, but the yeast spreads into a loaf. And like, you can smell it. You know that smell of bread? Like when you're walking in a marketplace, like, it smells good. Hopefully gluten-free, because I want some of that. Well, that's the idea. Like the kingdom should be wafting from us. It's a smell. It's not so much a hammer. Let me hammer the truth down your throat as much as it's a smell. I'm inviting you in. It's compelling.
God loves each one of us as if there was only one of us to love. You're not just a face in a crowd. You're the apple of his eye. He's a good shepherd who will leave the 99 because he's one who's never once left the one behind. He's not only a deity who sits on top of the mountain, inviting a generation to climb Zion and seek the face of the God of Jacob, but also a caring, nurturing comforter who gives full attention to the individual. Inviting you to be born of water and spirit, to cover yourself under the shadow of his wing. No matter how unloved or lost you feel, God knows your name. counts your hairs, holds your hand, and has your back. Immerse yourself in his unconquerable benevolence, enduring mercy, sufficient grace, and incandescent care. He loves you.
The anointing oil in the Old Testament, it was made of cinnamon, myrrh, and other natural ingredients. Paul the Apostle told the Corinthians, you bear about within yourselves the fragrance of Christ. So that's what Paul said to the Corinthians, you bear about within yourselves the fragrance of Christ. And the Bible says in the New Testament, we are a kingdom of priests. So we are the priests. So as a kingdom of priests, we should bear about ourselves, Paul told the Corinthians, the fragrance of Christ. So Jesus is our great high priest. Notice how it says, running down on the edge of his garments, verse 2, because Jesus is a great high priest who could be touched with our infirmities, Hebrews says. He's our great high priest who could be touched with our weaknesses and our sicknesses. So that woman touched the edge of the priest's garments and she found healing there because you could touch the edge of his garments and the priest had healing flowing from the edge of his garments because he could be touched with infirmities and sicknesses and that's where healing virtue flowed from. But this anointing oil, super interesting stuff. It had this fragrance, myrrh, cinnamon, natural ingredients. The priests, when they would serve in the tabernacle, don't look at the clock, anybody. When they serve in the tabernacle, when they would go into the altar of incense, I don't have time to break down the tabernacle right now. They would go to the altar of incense and they would offer up something that was totally unique. And they would grind the incense to powder and then they would add salt to it. They would add salt to it. You're the salt of the earth, also a kingdom of priests. Frankincense, and Jesus is the great high priest who was offered frankincense as a baby.
De Beneficiis Messiah. That's the nickname of Psalm 117 when the author says, praise the Lord and laud him. Why should we praise the Lord? The Jewish doctors tell us that that chapter was written to be a benefit of the Christos and the coming Mashiach. And indeed, Paul referred to Jesus in 1 Timothy 6:2 as the benefit. John 4:10 refers to Jesus as the gift of God. Haggai refers to Jesus, the coming Messiah, as the desire of all nations. And Luke 2 refers to Jesus as being great tidings of joy to all people. So too, I want to encourage you that the Christ dimension can live through you so that you no longer live, but now you have the gift, the benefit, the desire of all nations, and the glad tidings of great joy manifested through you when you simply put your faith and trust in the Father who sent his Son to image him to the world. By faith, the Christ dimension will be manifested through you too.
I love this idea of the presence of God being something that smelled really good. It was super fragrant. So you have all these good smells, the incense, the cologne, as it were, on the priest. You were never allowed to copy that because the presence of God is something you can never copy. The presence of God is something you can't imitate. People can look beautiful on the outside. They can spray themselves with Burberry all they want. But the most aromatic, fragrant atmosphere a person can ever have is when they go to the altar of incense, when they go to the presence of God, and even further into the most holy place. There is nothing that will give you a fragrance, a beauty. There's nothing more beautiful than when we dwell together in love and harmony because we have the aroma of the Lord wafting off of us. There is nothing as compelling or fragrant as the presence. The presence, the presence. You say, Ben, all you talk about is the presence. You better believe it because there's nothing else to talk about. There's nothing else. It's everything. It's everywhere.
The woods were enchanted and ripe for friend ventures as we floated through God's creation, breathing in the sky and listening to the roaring waterfalls. It felt as though the trees might break into a dance at any moment if we turned our back on them. There are few things as magical as hanging out with friends in forests. George MacDonald warned us not to sabotage or deconstruct nature through microscopes and science, but to let its beauty have its way with us. Instead of analyzing and dissecting it,
to try to understand what you are seeing, he suggested you should just let the magic of God's world wash over you. G.K. Chesterton encouraged his readers to be childlike in the face of nature and compared the created world to a toy that we should play with. He knew that when children take their toys apart to try to see what makes them work, it ruins part of the fun. Just play about in the cosmos as is. Remember, when you tear apart that toy to examine it more closely, it never works the way it used to when you try to put it back together. You just need to let it be and enjoy it for what it is. The created world is the same way. As fascinating as quantum theory is, sometimes you just have to put away the lab coat, put away the microscope, and enjoy the magic right before your eyes.
To behold the beauty of the Lord, to dwell forevermore in his tabernacle, in his presence, to inquire in his temple, you can't fabricate it. You can't manufacture it. This is a compound that you can't copy. There is nothing that will make you more fragrant than being in the presence. See, the presence of God, when I talk about it, it's not just something for you to get your serotonin overflow, for you to get your spiritual high. The presence of God is something that will be so compelling when you go out of the tabernacle and minister to the people as a kingdom of priests, nothing will draw people in more than the fragrance. Nothing will draw people into the kingdom more than when they smell the bread wafting because the woman kneaded the dough with the yeast that spread. This is what draws other people in. So you couldn't copy the presence. Now, here's what's interesting. Before you think this only had religious connotations, did you know the anointing with oil in the original Hebrew language specifically had to do with secular context? So the word anointing with oil, what it literally meant, anointing, meant to smear or to slather. So it's not something that's passive, like, oh, just a little drop of oil. It's very aggressive. It's like smear with oil. Like slather with oil. Here's some historical context. You ready for this? The anointing with oil was actually used of a soldier who would slather or smear his shield with anointing oil. He'd anoint his shield for battle. It was also used of a person building a house when he would paint the house. He would anoint the house when he would slather paint on the house. Another one was, this is perfect, when one would anoint a body, you would slather or smear oil on a body. Now, this is super sick. My brother, Peter John, taught this. Jesus, when he was anointed with oil, aromatic perfume, the alabaster box, within about a week of him dying, he said, she has anointed my body for burial, which is what they would do. The Hebrew word meant a soldier anointing a shield, a person anointing a house with paint, or a person anointing a body with oil. She washed Jesus' feet with an alabaster jar, beautiful, just in the presence. In the ancient Jewish scriptures, there's this vision that a prophet named Ezekiel has of a river flowing out of the temple. Now, the temple represented the presence of God, and out of the presence flows a river of water. Now, the New Testament says that our body is the temple for the Holy Spirit, and Jesus said, out of our temple will flow forth torrents of living water. This spake he of the Holy Spirit. Now, what's interesting is, as Ezekiel is walking down the river flowing from the temple, an unnamed guide leads him along the riverbanks. And at first, the waters only go up to Ezekiel's ankles. He's playing in the shallows. But the further along he walks, the stronger the river becomes. And then it goes up to his knees. The further along he walks, it suddenly goes up to his waist. Finally, Ezekiel finds that the river is so deep, he can't even swim in it. He's in over his head. That, my friends, is the center of everything. It's going into the deeps, flowing in the river, floating in the presence, because how much you're willing to experience depth in the healing waters of the presence of God directly determines how much healing you're going to have in your life. Ezekiel tells us that these waters bring healing to the land and water a tree whose leaves give medicine. So too, I want to encourage you, float in the presence, go with the flow, go with the river, be born of water and spirit, because as you plumb the deeps of the presence,
That's when you're gonna find fulfillment. That's when you're gonna find happiness. That's when you're gonna find peace. And that's when you're going to find healing. It's in the presence.
The anointing oil cannot be manufactured, fabricated, copied, or imitated. It has to be authentic, bona fide, and genuine. And we're gonna learn more about this unique anointing oil in our next episode.
We've started a second YouTube channel. For those of you who are looking for shorter YouTube teaching clips, you can go to youtube.com/Ben Courson, and there you're gonna find very brief, short teaching clips, because the mind can only absorb what the seat can endure. So if you're in need of quick hope on the go, then make sure to subscribe to our channel by going to youtube.com/Ben Courson. Hey guys, Ben Courson here. Have you ever felt so hopeless and despairing that you were in a pit that you could not climb out of? Believe it or not, I've been through that exact season. For 10 to 11 years of my life, I struggled with suicide ideation, where I was so depressed that my future seemed to be swallowed by an infinite gray, and all I could look forward to was hopelessness and pain. But then, the God of hope rescued me. I've learned that when I walk with, talk to, follow after, lean into, depend upon, and live for the God of hope, I find my joy restored, and I find a holy happiness, a calm delight, and a sacred optimism beginning to infiltrate my spirit. That's why we started this YouTube channel. We're gonna give you the true good news of the gospel of the God of hope. So you hit that bell icon, you subscribe, like the videos, and share them with your friends. And let's change this world and give our generation hope. We have hope because the Bible says Jesus Christ is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords who put death to death. So we don't have to be scared to death of death. At the place of the skull, he crushed the skull of the serpent with the crown of thorns on his skull. The Bible says he's the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, Emmanuel, Messiah, the Prince of Peace, the Son of God, the Light of the World, the Way, the Truth, the Life, the Lion of the Tribe of Judah, the Door for his sheep, the Shepherd who lays down his life for his lambs, the Vine who gives fruit to his branches, the Word of God made flesh, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the end, the resurrection, and the life. Shall I go on? The Prince of the Kings of the Earth, the Amen, the Root of David, the Man-Child, the beginning of God's creation, He who wields the bright and morning star, He who holds the double-edged sword, the Captain of our salvation, the image of the invisible God, and the anchor of hope, #low-key world domination, no big deal.